Today on Upfront, the job special session is over. Did lawmakers get the job done?
Jobs takes the front seat, and it will continue to take the front seat until we can get this economy turned around.
The focus has been on anything but jobs. All you have to do is look at a list of some of these bills.
Then a referendum on collective bargaining in Ohio. What polls say might happen to the law that most closely resembles Wisconsin's. And the latest Republican candidate for U.S. Senate. Will opposition to federal health care reform be his signature issue? It's all this week on Upfront.
Honest, candid, insightful. This is Upfront with Mike Gushay.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Upfront. Remember a few weeks ago when the governor called a session on jobs? Well, both the special and the regular session of the legislature just ended, and today on Upfront, we're asking what happened with the jobs agenda. Last week, we saw lawmakers pass bills on sex education in schools, gun owner rights, and briefly consider changing the rules for recall elections before putting that idea on hold. But what about jobs? We've invited Senator Mary Lazich, the Republican from New Berlin, and Senator Chris Larson, the Democrat from Milwaukee, to join us today. And we thank both of you for being with us.
Thank you.
Let's ask that question. Did jobs take a backseat to other, perhaps less important matters?
No, not at all. Jobs takes the front seat, and it will continue to take the front seat until we can get this economy turned around. The legislature is very focused, like a laser. We created the Economic Development Corporation that Scott Walker created, invented, and took the Department of Commerce and totally reinvented, totally changed it. And it has a laser focus. And we have Paul Jaden and his folks out there every day working on jobs and letting us know what they need in legislation and what we can do to assist them, and also where we can stay out of the way. And a lot of it is regulations. We've worked really hard to loosen regulations to make our state similar to other states, to make it user-friendly to businesses, to get businesses to come to Wisconsin, to get businesses that are here to stay. The first day of the session this week, we dealt with jobs bills. And yes, we did some other things, but jobs has been the focus.
Let me have the Democratic response here.
The focus has been on anything but jobs. All you have to do is look at a list of some of these bills. You know, the Castle Doctrine, how many jobs is that going to create? Repealing the Healthy Youth Act, my imagination runs wild trying to figure out how that creates jobs. Enforcing trespassers, making sure that trespassers are held accountable. I mean, what kind of jobs are we talking about here? It's all over the place, and that's not even bringing into account the permanent power grab that we saw, where they're trying to, where Senator Lazich is writing these bills to say that we have new districts that are new and permanent to try and help Republicans and trying to force new hurdles on people pushing recalls.
Well, we'll get to that in just a moment, but let me have you address one of the pieces of legislation that you're a strong proponent of, and this is changing the way sex education is taught in our schools. It gives, as you call it, local school districts more control over what they teach, but it promotes abstinence in marriage. Why was that necessary?
Well, what we have right now under the law that Governor Doyle and the Democrats put in place last session, we have a heavy-duty state mandate that if they teach sex education, it must be comprehensive education. So they're a broad category. And there's a lot of school districts and parents that aren't comfortable with that. Now, what this bill does is it takes away that heavy-duty state mandate, and it allows the school districts to design and implement curriculum. So if they want the heavy-duty comprehensive sex ed, they can continue doing that. We do not take that away. We do not take that component away. But what we do give them the option of is an abstinence education, if the district wants that, somewhere in between there. We make it a local control school district issue, and we say state government, stay out of it. Stay out of that issue. That's a sensitive area.
So you say it's local control. What's wrong with that argument?
This is there's not different local definitions of what is medically accurate, and that's what this bill reversed. It gutted the definition of what is medically accurate and kind of leaves it to the locals to do that. And
disagree with the message that abstinence is a good idea for teenagers.
No, abstinence should be a part of it, but you know, trying to pretend that kids aren't going to learn about sex at some point, teenagers, young adults, it's like not teaching driver's ed and just hoping and praying they don't get into accidents and pretending that cars don't exist. They're going to figure it out. It's either we're going to have it from professionals in a curriculum that goes by medically accurate information, or it's going to be through Google searches and reality TV. So we're not against the idea of abstinence. We're not against that. We want to just make sure that they have all the information that's available to them.
Let me touch briefly on the castle doctrine, this new law that gives immunity to homeowners if an intruder comes into their house and, for example, they were to shoot them. You tweeted on this. You called it the Kill the Milkman bill. Is that correct?
Yeah, there's a lot of bills.
Isn't that kind of silly, I mean, to refer to it that way?
Absolutely. I mean, this bill is silly.
It
solves absolutely no cases. There are no cases in our state where this has been an issue. It assumes that if somebody comes into your house and you confront that person in a logical way and that you take them and make them accountable, that you're going to be held liable for it. And that's not the case. There's no cases that could be cited. All this does is it gives blanket, it gives the ability for a person to kill somebody in their house without accountability. It gives them immunity. So basically, I mean, I called it the death of a salesman. You could call it the end of door-to-door campaigning, where somebody knocks on your door and that's it. I thought I was going to be attacked. You could call it dad just ruined hide-and-go-seek for everyone, because all you could say is, oh, I thought I was going to be attacked. Immunity. It solves no problem. It is a joke.
Let me have you respond to his point. And the point is the Milwaukee County DA says, we don't need this. We already have legislation that addresses this matter. And for the party of small government to create yet another law when it's not needed, how does that make sense?
Well, the example that Senator Larson used, that you knock on the door, and by knocking on the door, you're going to get... you're going to get killed and you're going to have this presumption of innocence. That's not true at all. It is not that at all. Right now, current law is you have the right to defend yourself, right, and use force, mm-hmm, force and great bodily harm if you feel threatened. What this does is put the property owner in charge of his property and not the criminal. The criminal can't come onto the property and you're forced to use this great bodily harm, and then you go into court and you don't have a presumption of self-defense.
But what was the need? How many cases of this kind have we seen in the state?
I think the author of the bill had some examples on that. But importantly, nearly 30 other states have this castle doctrine, and very importantly, this was a bipartisan vote.
Well, that is
bill.
Important to point out. Three
nine,
of your colleagues.
Nine out of 16 Democrats voted for the bill.
Three of your colleagues in the Milwaukee area voted for.
Right. That's fine. You know, again, you know, it sounds like a cool thing, castle doctrine, you know, but this is something, it's unnecessary. It's built off of scary movies, you know, oh, someone's going to come into my house and I'm going to need to confront them. But policy based off of bad movies is bad policy. And the fact is, again, this has nothing to do with jobs. Absolutely nothing. It's something that appeals to a far-right extreme. It has no place in reality. There's no cases cited. It's just something that they're throwing out there. And it has nothing to do with jobs. Nothing to do with what people really want in our state.
If criminals have more rights than victims, that's a huge problem. If we're giving criminals more rights to go onto people's property and have more power and to be able to go on and hurt people, hurt families, hurt children, and we don't want to protect the victims.
They don't, and that's
not
the case.
If that's far right, wow.
There is no logic to that. As much of a good talking point that is, there is no case law, there are no cases behind it. It sounds good, but it's not real. It's not reality.
Very briefly, the recall matter that you originally proposed, you wanted to have the newly redrawn districts in Senate districts used for these recalls. That did not ultimately end up being voted on. Is that completely dead now?
Well, remember, what's very important, and very important for people to understand, because this is such a complicated, confusing time, because the recalls play in. In past years, when we had redistricting every 10 years, it naturally played itself out with the elections. It's different this time. The odd-numbered Senate districts are not up for election. Those senators have 3 years left on their term. And what's very important, in those odd-numbered Senate districts, the senators now represent the new district. They don't represent the old district. But the old district is the one that would recall them according to current law.
So you say it's confusing, but not about improving the chances of Republicans surviving recalls.
It's about fairness for voters across the state of Wisconsin. There's 300,000 voters that wouldn't be able to recall their senator and wouldn't be able to vote for their senator. If there were a recall election, the senator represents the new district, but people outside of the district make the decision, and people in the district can't vote. They cannot vote. That is not fair.
I'm just running short on time. I'm going to give you the final word on this subject.
Right. This is just a...
She says it's confusing. And it is to a lot of people who are saying, what district do I live in now?
Sure. I mean, if you look at the math, this is something where the timeline's coming up where people can hold their Republican senators accountable that were elected a year ago that refused to listen to them. And so they said, oh, we need to change the districts immediately to make sure that they can't. This has nothing to do with anything other than protecting the power grab that they had originally. It's so extreme that even members of the Republican Party came out against it, and it's not going to move forward.
Senator Chris Larson, the Democrat from Milwaukee, Senator Mary Lazich, the Republican from New Berlin. Appreciate your time today. Thanks very much for being with us. Next, the latest Republican to explore running for U.S. Senate. Has he single-handedly stopped federal health care reform in Wisconsin? And later, Ohio's collective bargaining law. Is it about to be repealed?
Upfront with Mike Goucher, brought to you by American Transmission Company and the Wisconsin Corn Growers Association.